I'm very pleased to be here tonight. I've been asked to talk about The Cross and the Lynching Tree, my most recent book. And so the title is Wrestling with the Cross and the Lynching Tree. And I want to begin with a quotation from Acts 10:39. They put him to death by hanging him on a tree. People have often asked me, which one of my books is my favorite? And I really couldn't say. It was like choosing one of my children. But with The Cross and the Lynching Tree, I do now have a favorite. I've also been asked, how long did it take me to write The Cross and the Lynching Tree? The formal time was about 10 years of research, thinking, and writing. I wrote many drafts before it reached its published form. However, in the deepest sense, I've been writing this book all my life. I put my whole being into it and did not hold anything back. It was like I didn't choose to write it. The Cross and the Lynching Tree chose me. I took my time and chose my words very carefully, as if the integrity of Black faith and the freedom struggle that arose out of it were at stake. And I'm still writing it. And it will not be finished until I draw my last breath. I remember when I first sat down to write The Cross and the Lynching Tree. It was a transforming experience, empowering me to say things with clarity and power that even surprised me. Since that Kairos moment, I have been reading, thinking, and writing almost daily, trying to make sense out of how African Americans survived and resisted four centuries of the terror of white supremacy. The Cross and the Lynching Tree focused on a special moment in my effort to make sense out of the lynching terror and the Black resistance to it. This book engaged my mind, heart, and soul like no other subject. For years, I have been wrestling with the paradox of Jesus' crucifixion and the lynching of African Americans. Reading, writing, and talking about it in my classes at Union, in lectures and sermons at seminaries, colleges, universities, and churches, community groups, and even on TV and radio shows, and with anybody who would listen to me. The more I researched and wrote, the more I realized that this book had to be written with the most creative, theological, and literary imagination I could muster, and with the best prose I could create. The subject was too important for a half-hearted and second-rate intellectual effort. I often wondered whether I had the literary talent to write the kind of book that the subject deserved. I'm not James Baldwin or Toni Morrison, and I only have so much writing talent. As I was writing, I prayed over and over to the God of the universe to give me the wisdom, the insight, and especially the courage to write the truth about the black religious experience in the United States. I hope that I've written a book that bears witness to black people's struggle for justice and to the faith that empowered them and sustained them to fight against great odds. Without qualification, I can honestly say I did my best. To do less would have been a theological sin. The question that I've been wrestling with is this: how did African Americans survive and resist the lynching terror and keep their sanity, keep enough of it to love and marry each other, to raise their children, and teach them to love and to respect each other? The answer is clear. For many blacks, it was their faith in God and in themselves that kept them emotionally and spiritually healthy enough to love not only themselves, but even the whites who lynched them. What an amazing ethical accomplishment. Whites used Christianity to lynch blacks, and blacks used it to survive and to resist whites. The more I reflected on the cross and the lynching tree, the more I understood why black Christians could not turn away from the cross. Even though that cross was used to enslave, segregate, and to lynch them. As James Baldwin said, whites discovered the cross by way of the Bible, but black people discovered the Bible by way of the cross. This is the great paradox of black life. The cross sits at the center of the gospel of Jesus, and also at the center of black life in the United States, taking the form of a lynching tree. I have spent a lifetime pointing out the hypocrisy and the mendacity of the white church in a white-dominated society, while lifting and exalting the voices and the experiences of the oppressed. I write out of my experience as an African American growing up in segregated Arkansas. And I write out of a deep theological conviction that the true power of the Christian gospel is an unambiguous call for liberation from the forces of oppression and a fierce and uncompromising condemnation of those who oppress. I write for the crucified people of history. I write for the forgotten and the abused, the marginalized and the despised. I write for those who are penniless, jobless, landless, and who have no social and political power. I write for gays, lesbians, bisexuals, and those who are transgender. I write for immigrants stranded on the U.S. border and for undocumented farm workers toiling in misery in our nation's agriculture fields. I write for Palestinians in the Gaza Strip and on the West Bank and in East Jerusalem. I write for Muslims, refugees who live under the terror of war in Iraq and Afghanistan and in Syria. I write for all people who care about humanity. I believe that until Americans, especially Christians, can see the cross and the lynching tree together, until we can identify Christ with re-crucified black bodies hanging from lynching trees, there can be no genuine understanding of Christian identity in America. Amen. And no deliverance from this brutal legacy of slavery and white supremacy. As I started reading about lynching and about the historical situations of crosses in Rome during the time of Jesus, I kept asking myself, how did African Americans survive and resist this lynching terror? How did they do it? There were nearly 5,000 African American men, women, and children who were lynched in America following the Civil War, and their devastated families were left behind to cope with great loss. Fathers and mothers, brothers and sisters, uncles and aunts, nephews and nieces, cousins and friends, and other loved ones strung up on trees, burned beyond recognition. Often their body parts distributed among the mobs as souvenirs. No blacks were exempted from the horror of the lynching tree. To live every day under the terror of death is no easy matter. I grew up in Arkansas, a lynching state. I know from experience something about lynching. I watched my mother and father deal with the memory and the threats of lynching, which they talked to with their three sons. But the moment I read about it, examining lynching historically, listening to Billie Holiday sing Strange Fruit, I couldn't stop thinking that I might have been one of those black bodies swinging in the southern breeze. And my father and brothers and even my mother could have been strange fruit hanging from the poplar trees. It was a horrifying nightmare to think and to dream about that strange and bitter crop. It shook me at the core of my being, disrupting my theological identity and making this book the most difficult and painful book I have written. The lynching horror is in my blood, flowing through my body. Lynching images appeared in my dreams and forced me to ask again and again, how in the world did blacks survive, not only physically, but most importantly, emotionally and spiritually, keeping their sanity in the midst of all that horror? I discovered that as strange and as paradoxically as it may appear, it was their identification with the cross in which Jesus was brutally crucified that kept many blacks out of the madhouse. That was why they sang with such passion, "Jesus, keep me near the cross." It was their faith in Jesus' cross, believing that if God was with Jesus, God must be with us, because we are up on the cross too. My other question was, how could white Christians who say they believe Jesus died on the cross to save them, how could they then turn around and put blacks on crosses and crucify them just like the Romans crucified Jesus? That was an amazing theological paradox to me. African Americans used their faith to survive and resist, while whites used theirs in order to terrorize black people. Two communities, both Christians, embracing the same faith. Whites even did lynchings on church grounds. Think about that. How could they do it? That's where my passion came from. As I wrote this text, that's where the paradox came from. That's where my theological wrestling came from. Now, many Christians embrace the conviction that Jesus died on the cross to redeem humankind from sin. Taking our place, they say, Jesus suffered on the cross and gave his life as a ransom for many. You've heard it. The cross is the great symbol of the Christian narrative of salvation. But unfortunately, during the course of 2,000 years of Christian history, the cross as a symbol of salvation has been detached from the ongoing suffering and oppression of human beings, the crucified people of history. The cross has been transformed into a harmless, non-offensive ornament that Christians wear around their necks. You know it. Rather than reminding us of the cost of discipleship, it has become a form of cheap grace, as Dietrich Bonhoeffer put it. It's become an easy way to salvation that doesn't force us to confront Christ's message and mission. Well, in writing this book, I found my inspiration in the faith of black people and in militant black ministers like Martin Luther King Jr. and Malcolm X, along with writers like James Baldwin, Ida B. Wells, and Richard Wright, as well as in great blues artists of my youth. These ministers, artists, and writers gave me a sense of awe and imagination in the presence of humanity fighting for justice against great odds. I saw that for most ordinary blacks, it was the blues and religion that offered them the chief weapons of resistance. It was religion and the blues that offered sources of hope that there was more to life than what one encountered daily in the white man's world. And in the words of the great poets and writers, in the great blues singers and the thunderous voices of the black church, I discovered that those who were able to confront the bleakness of their lives and yet defy fate and suffering and make the most of what little life had to offer them, through these connections, I found a way to respond to black suffering in all of its forms. You see, being Christian is somewhat like being black. It's a paradox, a profound contradiction with many incongruities. You grow up black, and you can't help but wonder why whites treat you like you're not a human being. It is hard to figure it out, especially when you're an innocent child. And yet at the same time, my mother and father told me, don't you hate like they hate. Hatred is too heavy a sack to carry, wrote James Baldwin. It was my parents' faith that gave them the inner resources to transcend the brutality and to see the beauty in the tragedy of their lives. It is a mystery, a profound and deep mystery, how African Americans, after 2.5 centuries of slavery and another century of lynching and Jim Crow segregation, and yet many of us still come out loving white people. Yeah. It's amazing. Now, unlike many blacks, I don't ever remember wishing that I was white. Because being black in Bearden, Arkansas, and Macedonia AME Church was so wonderful and beautiful, especially as I saw blackness embodied in the lives of my mother and father and in the host of other proud women and men in Arkansas. The reality of love in my own community was so strong, so real, that I didn't have time to think about being white. I just truly love being black. The spiritual values of my parents and other blacks were so important, much more important than the material things I saw in the white world that hated me. Black music and black dance, black loving and hugging, kissing, black preaching and singing, everything black was much more interesting and inspiring. The beauty of blackness was everywhere in Beard. As we, Joe Louis knocking out Maxwell with power and grace. Jesse Owens running with pride for his people in the face of white supremacy and Hitler's hate. Jackie Robinson, Willie Mays running, catching, sliding, making art on a baseball diamond. Making art on a baseball. You ever watch Willie Mays and Jackie Robinson? Black people can make art out of anything. They can. They can put their stamp, their signature on it. That's why the NFL has to put rules in. To tame black people. So there was so much love about blackness. Whether in the juke joint or at the dance hall, black bodies were swinging and moving to the blues sound of B.B. King and Muddy Waters, or in church listening to the sound of Sister Ora Wallace singing, "I'm working on the building." And my mother, Lucy Cone, God bless her soul, raising her voice, proclaiming this little light of mine. Black beauty was all over Bearden, in the laughter and in the play of blacks, the style of black talk and walk. As a child, I was in my element, for blackness save me from whiteness and kept me sane and believing that I was somebody. Now, how do people know that they are somebody in a world that says that they have few economic and political resources to defend their humanity? So few economic resources to physically survive, and so few educational resources to express their somebody-ness. How did they know they somebody? For many blacks, it was their faith, which was inseparable from their culture. That was why I called the blues secular spirituals. The blues are spiritual resources that enable black people to express their humanity. James Baldwin only finished high school. Richard Wright, only the eighth grade. But they had their say. And thereby bore witness to the transcendence of blackness that no one could destroy. Blackness is the image of God in black people. A tremendous spiritual condition. As James Baldwin put it, blackness is the light in the white darkness. B.B. King never got out of grade school, and Louis Armstrong hardly went to any school at all. Now, I said to myself, if Louis Armstrong could blow a trumpet like that, forget it. I'm going to write theology the way Louis Armstrong blows that trumpet. And the way Billie Holiday sings Strange Fruit, improvising as I write, letting it all hang out, expressing the souls of black folk, our spiritual strivings, as W.E.B. Du Bois put it, refusing to follow a theological methodology defined by white theologians. Negro blood, wrote W.E.B. Du Bois, has a message for the world. And he was right. I want to speak a message of liberation. I want to reach deep down into black existence for those cultural and spiritual resources that enable African Americans to express themselves even when the world said they had nothing to say. I remember growing up in Arkansas, and blacks had to wear a lot of masks. As the great poet Paul Laurence Dunbar put it, we wore the mask that grins and lies. Yeah. I wore a mask in Arkansas as a child when I went downtown to white people's town and other places in Arkansas where white people were, but not in my own community. I wore a mask in the white community because I knew what they could do to my family and to me. I wore a mask even in graduate school because I had to find a way to graduate in an academic environment that refused to acknowledge my humanity. But I kept saying to myself, one of these days, I'm going to take that mask off and say what I think to white people and make up for lost time. And so for the last 40-something years, that's what I've been doing. I write to encourage African Americans to take off their mask, get in touch with their inner blackness in order to have their say, and to say it clearly, forcefully, truthfully as they can. But be careful. When you take your mask off, don't be foolish. Not all blacks could reveal their true self because white people still have a lot of power, yeah, controlling their employment, yeah. Yeah. Often their physical and social well-being. I took my mask off when I wrote my first book 3 years after graduate school. You must be ready for white reactionary racist response when black people speak the truth about white supremacy in America. Whites do not like straight talking, independent thinking, uppity Negroes. They try to keep them in their place and make an example of them. But I got tenure. Yeah. Ain't no need of having it if you ain't gonna use it now. Now, my mother and father did not have my opportunity. So when I write and when I speak, I try to write and speak for them. That is crossing the Lynching tree is Lucy and Charlie Cone's book, and all the blacks who struggle against the terror of the Lynching tree. My mother and father and other blacks in Bearden never had a chance to stand before white people as I do and tell them what you really think. I have to do that for them. I try to do it all over the world. And when I sit down to write, I stand up to talk, as I am now, I think of Lucy and Charlie Cone and all the other Lucys and Charlie Cones, the maids and the janitors, who are out there and who cannot speak. I feel their spirit flowing through my body, encouraging me to speak the truth, son. They deepen my spirituality and give me something to hold on to, something I can feel in the depths of my being, giving me strength and courage to say it like it is. It was a very profound spiritual experience writing and talking about this book, Crossing the Lynching Tree, because I was doing something for people I love who could not and would never have a chance to say what they feel. So, I felt deeply the need to speak for people who could not speak. Those, as Martin King says, who have been left out of the sunlight of opportunity. If there is passion in what I write, that's because I'm thinking of Lucy and Charlie, my daddy and my mama, trying to do justice to their courage and their faith. And all the things they taught me, that's why I'm here. And as long as I can do that, I think I'll stay on the right track, bearing witness as best I can to the black blood that is flowing in the streets, the jails, and even in our churches. And in the byways of America. Thank you.